Shut up!
Welcome back to Conversations with Carol and Cheryl. Today we have a special guest, Julie, who is going to talk about making peace with her anxiety. I encourage you to go into our show notes and visit Julie's blog to get more information about her and enjoy her writings. Welcome to the show, Julie. Where would you like to start?
First of all, I'll just start by saying that I really was raised by the two best people that I know. My parents are just awesome in every way possible. Really just the biggest support that someone with anxiety could ask for. And the way that she described it to me was, Julie, you just were born anxious. And I'd never really heard that before, to have someone be born with an anxious demeanor, wired in that. And I started seeing a child psychologist, I think when I was about 6 or 7. My mom had just had major heart surgery, and that was just like a big traumatic event for a first grader, you know, having to go through that. I think manifested itself in multiple ways growing up. I had really bad separation anxiety from my parents. I remember I would freak out. I went to this daycare after school, and if they were even like 5 minutes late picking me up, I would just have a meltdown. And then even as I like got into my teens, manifested itself in don't get good enough grades, and then I'm not going to get into college, and then I'm just going to be a failure, and my parents are going to be so disappointed in me, I'm going to be disappointed in myself, to like, oh my gosh, you're 26 and you're single and you're never going to find someone and you're going to end up alone being a cat lady and you don't even like cats. What is this? So it really got to a point where September 2016, I just remember thinking, gee, like my anxiety and my depression is just really impacting. I was really good at hiding it, so none of my friends or anyone who I worked with had any idea. Definitely impacted my family life. I ruined a lot of family dinners. I ruined a lot of vacations just because my depression and anxiety would just, it really brought out the worst in me. And I remember finally saying, I don't want to feel this way anymore. And the way that I describe it is everything is fine. Physically, everything is fine. It's a fine life, but I always felt like there was this rain cloud following me where it was sunny all around. Everyone else was sunny. I should be sunny, but I just have the rain cloud above my head. And I remember thinking that I don't want to feel that way anymore. So I finally decided to see a psychiatrist and got on antidepressants. And it really has made the world's difference. And it's not an end-all, cure-all, but it lifts your butt up a little bit.
I have a friend that had severe depression, and she said that, I asked her, do you feel like all happy when you take medicine? And she said, no, can almost look back and see how bad it was before. Isn't that the case for
yes.
you?
No, it's for sure the case.
That's what I find is a shame, is that people that don't know they're depressed, you almost have to get on something so that you can actually confirm if you are depressed.
Yeah.
So I think a lot of people go undiagnosed and don't even give it a chance to change themselves. That was the same case for you.
No, it definitely was. I feel like a totally different person. It just kind of reshapes, I don't want to say it reshapes your outlook, but it's really, for me, it serves as a chill pill. And I'm a very type A person. I like to plan. I like to have things the way that I'm expecting them to be. I don't like change. I don't like transition. I tend to be like very uptight, intense about things, but the antidepressants just kind of,
it's okay.
Sometimes things, patience and being a chill person is being okay with the fact that sometimes things don't work out the way you planned, and that's life. And it's also part of growing up. I don't say the pills changed everything, but I think it's just becoming more mature also and realizing that, okay, life has speed bumps and it's okay if it doesn't go the way that you wanted it to, or if it doesn't fit in with your 5-year plan. This is life. This is how you learn. And do I wish I lived an anxiety-free life? Absolutely. But that's just never, I've accepted the fact that I'm always going to have moments where I'm, oh my gosh, I feel uncomfortable, it's happening. And that's just how I am. And that's part of me.
You are wired the way you're wired. And I remember, and I've asked other people this, and I think I've only met one other person that said yes. I spent one evening as a child crying hysterically at the thought of losing both my parents. Have you ever had an episode like that?
Yeah. Just,
yeah.
I freak out about it now. I mean, I distinctly remember telling my parents just a couple weeks ago, like, because so I lost two grandparents in the past couple months, and that was really hard. That was my first experience with death for people like so close to me. And it's just shocking when you think, oh, these people who have been here my whole life, they're not there anymore. How do I function like living without them? And because they weren't my parents, I was a step removed. I was still very sad, but then it got me thinking, what if that happened to my parents? Like, I would be lost. I freak out about that regularly. Like, there's so many things that I feel like I don't know. Like, how do I buy a car? How do I buy a house?
Well, let me tell you something. I knew nothing. I bought a house. I've wheeled and dealt with cars. I've gone through a divorce. And if I had to sit down and tell you how I did it all, I couldn't. But you go through the motions and you do it.
Yep, life goes on.
You would be perfectly fine without your parents. I mean, you would, it's just amazing. It's just situations, you initiate them and then they just roll and you do it.
Yep, so life goes on.
Yeah.
So how did your mom help you with your anxiety when you were going through it?
So during the deep struggle, I call those the dark years, like hated both of my parents. I was like, you guys aren't helping. You don't understand what's going through my mind. You don't see how hard this is. They did, because my mom had been through it herself. And I think just the fact that they took my mental health seriously, the fact that they were like, oh, well, you need to go see someone, like you need help. I think that's like the biggest thing that they could have done.
Was this in 2016 or before?
I mean, this is all throughout my teen years. I've been in therapy on and off really my entire life almost. I think just being constant and there for me is, you know, says a lot.
It's a hard thing to understand because, like, you're talking sense to somebody and they know it, but something in your wiring is not accepting it.
Mm-hmm.
And you know they know it. That's a real tough one to be patient on and to deal with.
So did it turn out that you had learning disabilities or any other outside thing happening to create anxiety? So it was just all internal.
Yeah.
There were no outside things happening.
I wonder if things can trigger it, because when my mom and dad were going to leave the country, they were going to go to Spain and then Ireland, I had a severe migraine headache at school and had to come home. And ever since then, I had migraines and I called it OCD. Well, yeah, it was definitely OCD. I would have to wash my hands. I checked the burners. I pray a lot because I was worrying and all this stuff. And I really think that triggered it for me. Dormant and then a life event will trigger it.
I think what triggered it was my mom's surgery.
Yeah.
I think that was just very shocking and traumatic for a young child to go through.
So what about your brother? Did he think you were a drama queen just trying to get a lot of attention?
Probably. I mean, I think it's unfortunate because I think right now he does have a lot of resentment towards me because I did create so much drama and he was just kind of like sitting there, and I do feel really awful about that. And I think, like, I love him very much and we have a good relationship now, but I do think that he does have like a point of resentment towards me because ruined a lot of things growing up. Like, I wasn't a pleasant teenager at all.
What's the age difference?
4 years.
Okay.
Yeah, I think that's really common. I think it's hard for that other sibling because the one that has a learning disability, anxiety, OCD, they're getting all the attention. And here this other kid probably just doing their thing and they're not being recognized for anything. That's what happened to our family with my kids.
Right.
And it was hard. I mean, it was hard for everybody because everybody's kind of in the dynamic. So what about in high school? Did you experiment with illegal drugs or anything like that to kind of numb yourself? Or did you do retail therapy? Did you reach for something to comfort yourself?
No, I was definitely a goody two-shoes in high school. I never drank, never did drugs. I was a benchmark-oriented person, and they're just thrown at you your entire life, getting perfect grades, perfect test scores, doing all the extracurricular activities and being perfect at them. when you apply to colleges, are you meeting these benchmarks to get into the school that you want? When you apply for jobs, are you meeting the qualifications, the benchmarks to keep this job, to get this job in order to succeed?
And this is you putting this pressure on.
Yes.
You only, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
I mean, society. I'm really trying hard to recognize that there's no timeline in life. Everyone does it at their own pace. There's always going to be someone better off than you. There's always going to be someone worse off than you. I think I internalize a lot of things. Okay, I didn't get into my dream school, so that means I am a failure. That's kind of how my mind path went. You didn't get an A on this test. You are a dumbass, which is really mean. And I was really mean to myself. And I think that part of it was anxiety and depression. Also, I think that's kind of how growing up in the information age, where it is such a competitive environment, especially in this area, you had to make the cut, because if you didn't, then like, how are you ever going to be successful later in life?
I think that's a lot, this area, the pressure that's put on young people to hit those benchmarks. And I know as a parent, I wanted my kids to hit those benchmarks because that made me a good mom.
Right.
If they weren't, then I was a failure as a mom. If the kids weren't, they were a failure as a kid. So there is a lot of pressure. And then there's the bragging rights. And they play on Division I lacrosse, or they made a junior Olympic cut on the swim team. That is like a reflection of me as a mom. This is what I thought. Now I understand, because I have a kid who didn't hit those benchmarks. I have one that did and one that didn't, that it really has nothing to do with me as a parent.
Right.
That it's all about the kid, and putting those pressures on is not helpful.
Right.
At the end of it. It doesn't accomplish anything.
Right. And now I ask myself, okay, what is success? What does success look like to you? And I think that that's a question that can yield very different answers from different people. If you asked me 10 years ago what success at 26 would look like, all right, well, I'd be married, working, doing whatever. But now I'm okay. Well, am I successful at 26? I'm financially independent. I live by myself. I have a job. I pay my bills. I have friends. That is successful, I would argue. Mm-hmm. And I think it really just depends on, but other people would not see that as successful because I'm not in a relationship. I'm not married. I don't have kids.
For me, the perfectionism is a way to avoid criticism. So if I'm perfect, nobody can criticize me. And what I realized about myself is I don't like criticism at all. I can barely tolerate it. But I had to separate the criticism into two categories. Criticism from people that matter would be a very small group of people, maybe five people, and then criticism from society or people on the outside looking in. So for me, I had really had to analyze that perfectionism and look at the criticism. If somebody's criticizing me that I didn't get an A, and mostly they're not, it's just my own, in my own head, then I feel like I have to work harder. But I think the number one shame triggers for women is not being enough. So we're not skinny enough. We don't make enough money. I'm not pretty enough. I'm not smart enough. And I think society really puts that on women. And if you look at the women's soccer team, if you look at any successful woman, they're going to look at, point at their look. You know, oh, look at her. She's heavy. Or look at her. Her hair is weird. For us to feel like we're enough is so much work. For me personally, to say, okay, I'm right now, like you were saying, I'm 26. I'm financially independent. I'm educated. I pay my bills. To me, that's enough. That's amazing. Who are you comparing yourself to? So that's what I had to figure out for myself. The 56-year-old talking, I am enough, and I'm not perfect.
Right.
And if you want to criticize me, I'm open to listening. If you're one of the five people on my criticism team that are really trying to help me get to the next level and help me improve upon what I'm doing,
if you're just a hater over here, maybe another mom in the neighborhood who doesn't have all the information, then I really am not interested in your opinion. But I think it takes a lifetime to get to that place where you like yourself, you know, and you're comfortable in your own skin.
So how did it affect you in college with all this stress and you know, the benchmarks there?
College was a really interesting experience for me. I was thrown in where lots of people were talented and smart and pretty and successful. And something that, like, people don't tell you when you get into school is they say, okay, join all these clubs and organizations. That's how you make friends. That's how you know, you find your group. That's how you find your people. What they don't tell you is a lot of them, it's really competitive to get into certain clubs and organizations. And I think that feeds kind of the same feelings that you have in high school. They don't want me. Why am I not good enough to join this organization? Am I not good enough to mix in with these people? I was, you know, suddenly confronted with the fact that, oh, someone, a fellow student really, is telling me I am not good enough to get into this organization. What does that mean? Like, you're already in this new environment. You're already out of your comfort zone. For me, I was really homesick. I definitely had my moments where I would just cry, I want to be here. Come take me home, basically kind of a summer camp, but with college, and you're there and, you know, you're there to get your education. It was hard because at home I had all my comfort and I have someone taking care of me. And then all of a sudden you go to college and you're really on your own. And I think that's where people have so many vastly different experiences. You know, you have people who are very sheltered and then they go to college and they have the first taste of alcohol. Whoa, there's no parents here. I can do whatever I want. And then you have someone like me who was so used to the comforts of home. And then I get to college. I have to share my room. I have to share bathrooms. I don't know what I'm eating. I don't know, like, people in my classes. Do I join this club? Do I join that club? All of my friends are all over the place. I have to make new friends. And then you get into that. You get used to that. You get through it. You do all that. You come out of college. It's great. And then you kind of have to do that all over again in the real world, except it's on such a vastly different level because this is the rest of your life. You had all your friends in college, but then it's like, oh, well, everyone's all over the place and everyone has jobs. And suddenly I can't just go over to my friend's house at 2 a.m. and ask for a glass of wine because finals week and you can do that. But now it's, oh, all of your friends are busy. How do you make new friends? How do you navigate an office environment? And I think it's a lot of pressure. And I think that for parents, it can be hard to, like, grapple with what we're going through, making that transition between being in one place for 4 years. And then, especially if you move back home, that might be the same place, but it's also a completely different place for people. And I think that's, like, a real relationship tester because you're not the person you were when you left home. Your parents probably aren't the same people when you left home. How do you reconcile those relationships and how do you find a new normal? This is a big question and a big issue.
You don't think it takes a natural flow? Because you're right, you've named a lot of things that I wouldn't even consider that I would think are just natural flow. So I see what you're talking about.
It's a completely new flow that you have to figure out, especially if you're like me, where I moved home after I graduated. I had an internship at the White House, but it wasn't paying me, so I was still living at home. And all of a sudden, part of my parents kind of expected it to kind of go back to the way it was in high school, where I tell them where I was at. That's not how I lived my life anymore. It was, you know, I had that taste of freedom. I'm not under your roof. I'm under your roof, but I'm not under your roof anymore. We need to create boundaries. You don't need to know where I am every second of the day. Just trust that I'm an adult now and I can take care of myself. And of course I will, like, tell you where I am if I'm not going to be where I told you I was. Just learning to have trust in me. I am responsible. I'm not going to end up dead in a ditch. And it's a tough adjustment to not having that as much anymore.
That's, I can speak for the mom. That's a very tough adjustment for the mom. Mm-hmm. My daughter's 23 and I still have her on location.
Yeah. But it's not because you don't trust her.
No, it's not because I don't trust her at all.
Mom, mommy mode.
Yes. No, I totally get that.
Yeah, having some peace of mind.
Sometimes I'll be, if I come home for a weekend and I'm going to the store with my mom and we're shopping and we're crossing the street and she'll grab my hand and she'll say, wait, there's a car coming. And I'm like, Mom,
right?
I'm 26, you know, I know to look both ways.
Right.
And she's like, I know, I'm sorry. It's just habit. And I get that. Yeah. I get that. I really do.
That's cute.
Yeah.
Well, I think that's the reason kids should not be moving back home for a long period of time. It just doesn't work. Too hard to have too many cooks in the kitchen, don't you think?
Yeah. Well, and weird because, you know, I think they kind of create a new dynamic when you're gone and then you come back in. Like, I remember coming home and getting ready for dinner and my brother was sitting in my spot at the table and I was like, what are you doing?
That's funny.
To my side.
Yeah. I was like, what are you doing? Like, Daniel, like, get out. That's not your seat. And he was like, it is now. And I was, oh, lying crossed. Like, that's not, no. And they were like, oh, well, like, you're gone. So this is where, like, everyone sits now. And I'm like, that's not okay. Well, you just have to deal with it. And I was like, that's my seat. It's just like little things like that.
Yeah.
I mean, that's a very minor thing on the grand scheme of things, but...
But it's a great example.
Yeah.
Of how
and
the
just
dynamic
to show how
shifts.
Little to how big, you know?
Right.
Just
right.
A definite dynamic shift.
And suddenly, you're kind of the outsider, and you haven't been there for all the inside jokes and for all the family dinners for the past 4 years. I don't know, it's like when I found out that my family had a group chat without me, and I was like, what? You guys talk without me? How dare you?
You remind me of my daughter with that stuff. That's hilarious.
So what advice for the moms in this situation?
I think, one, recognizing that it is a hard transition coming back, especially if you don't have a job yet or if you're in the process of looking or even if you just started a new job. It's a lot of stress and there's a lot of stimuli coming at you at once. I know for me, even though I grew up in this area, I had never worked in the city. I had never really spent a lot. The last time I went to one of the Smithsonians was like on a sixth grade field trip. I don't know the city. I'm dealing with being in a workplace for the first time where there are so many unwritten rules that they just don't tell you about in school. There is the process of reconnecting with friends, making new friends. And then the fact that you go home, which is great because I got free room and board for the first 6 months post-grad. Also that there's so much pressure on us to succeed in our first jobs, to succeed in life, to have that Sex in the City style friendships automatic right off the bat, which is not the case at all, at least in my experience. And just being able to be supportive and recognizing that none of this is easy and just keeping an open line of communication, which I think is honestly the hardest part in any relationship. No one likes to talk about their weaknesses, but I think just like keeping in mind that we're going through a lot and we love you and we're appreciative of everything that you do, but recognize that we need our space.
All right. Thank you, Julie.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you.
It's a pleasure. We really enjoyed talking with you today.
I enjoyed talking with you all.